All right. What's the verdict from on high? Are we on? We're checking. All right, we're on. So, good evening. Good to see y'all. Good to see y'all here this evening. And so, I want us to pray. And just a couple of things that I'll mention in particular. One, I don't know really any of the details, but yesterday morning, Laura texted me and said, "Hey, I'm going to be late coming in. I just was behind and witnessed a really bad accident here on 158. And so apparently there was a lady in her 40s and a teenage passenger in the front seat, five young boys in the back seat. And it resulted, I think, in two life flight helicopter rides and three ambulance transports. And so I don't know any other details than that, but do want us to pray for that family, whatever is going on now. Pray for Laura, you know, as an ER nurse, and even one that's come up on several roadside accidents. I would have been a little more prepared for that. That's not something she's really ever done or had to deal with. So just pray for God's peace for her, especially with kids involved. And then also I want us to pray for Karen Watson's family. Her nephew, who is 39, who had some significant health issues already, but they discovered him dead at his home, as I understand it, just in the last day or so, or two. And so she's actually got a good bit of family at their house tonight. And so so I just told Clay that we would remember them in prayer tonight. So so let's pray for those things, pray for our time together, and then we'll jump right in. Father, thank you for the blessing and the privilege of gathering together as your people. God, thank you for the privilege of being your people. God, that you have saved us to yourself and that you've saved us together into a body. And God, thank you for the sounds of fellowship around the tables tonight. God, thank you for the opportunity to come together here to study and to talk about what it means to talk to you. Father, we pray for this family impacted by this accident yesterday morning. We pray for your grace and mercy toward them. We don't know anything about the situations of how the different ones are doing, but God, we pray that whatever the need is, you would just overwhelmingly meet it. According to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Father, we pray for Karen and her family. We pray that you would provide your comfort and peace. God, particularly to some of these family members that have lost now multiple family members in short time. God, we just pray for your overwhelming comfort for them. And God, for strength and grace for Clay and Karen, even as they seek to minister to their family. And so, God, we just ask you for that special strength for them. God, we pray for the activities going on here tonight for our preschool pals and for our M3 kids, for our students, and for us. God, that you would, by your Spirit, work to accomplish what you desire in our lives. We know you'll be faithful to do that. So help us just to be receptive to and obedient to what you say to us. And so we just ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Well, we are, we're turning the corner in our study tonight in this, again, I guess for those that are not here, or have not even been here, we're working through this book called Just Ask on prayer. The subtitle is The Joy of Confident, Bold, Patient, Relentless, Shameless, Dependent, Grateful, powerful, expectant prayer. And you'll remember in the first even couple of weeks, those were some of those words were the very ones that we looked at when we looked at how the scripture calls for us to pray. We also looked at reasons why we don't, right? So the first three chapters in the book had to do with why don't we pray? Does prayer do any good anyway? Why hasn't God answered yet? Those kinds of questions. And does my praying really change God's mind, right? Those are some of the questions that we looked at with regard to why we don't pray sometimes. Now we're moving into how to pray. And I just thought it was interesting that the first chapter as we approach the section on how to pray begins with how not to. There's a biblical precedent for that, though, right? I know several of you have gotten and been reading along in the book, which is great, but there is certainly a biblical precedent for that, and that is before Jesus taught his disciples to pray, he actually taught them how not to, right? Remember we said that the disciples even asked Jesus, Lord, teach us to pray. They see the magnitude of prayer in his life. They see him catching away to spend time with the Father in prayer and this kind of thing. And so they say, hey, teach us how to pray. And so so we see the biblical precedent. If you've got a Bible, turn to Matthew 6. And if you don't have one, there's one in the seat in front of you, should be. But Matthew 6, of course, this is the middle chapter in what we would call the Sermon on the Mount, as Jesus is teaching there on the hillside. And there in chapter 6, you get down to verse 5, and this is where Jesus is beginning this instruction to his disciples on prayer. And so I want us to just read these verses here, and then we'll go back and we'll talk about them and the importance of them. But we're going to just look this evening at Matthew 6, 5 through 8. And so this is what the Word of God says. Jesus is speaking, and he says, and when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do. For they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Now in the next couple of weeks, we're going to keep going, right, to look at how Jesus is going to instruct us in prayer, but he's going to begin with how not to. But isn't it interesting, what does he assume right there at the beginning of verse 5? What is right out of the gate, what does he assume? That you pray, doesn't he? Because he doesn't say, and if you should happen to sometime stumble onto praying, does he? He says, and when you pray. There's the assumption that you will pray. And the fact of the matter is, you don't have to look around very hard to realize most people, in light of or in spite of their faith or lack of it, still pray, don't they? Can you think of instances where people that aren't even believers, what would be an example? What would be a kind of context, a way that you would imagine that kind of a thing happening? Tragedy, sure. What else? Sickness, yep, asking for healing, for sure. What else? Yeah. Okay, sort of the celestial vending machine, right? I have this. Maybe my prayers will be effective coins in the vending machine of heaven. I can put them in. Hopefully, I'll hit the right button, say the right words, and out pops what I want, right? Oh shoot! I hit D3 and I meant the Snickers, and all of a sudden now I get the potato chips. You know, I must have not done it right. Sure. You know, you think about things like, you know, foxhole prayers. You were talking about tragedy, but even, you know, even those kinds of intense, in the moment, heavy circumstance, sort of just launch a prayer, as some people say, launch a prayer upward, hoping that it hits somewhere, right? But we see that everybody, whether out of their faith or sometimes in spite of it, to be honest with you, I have had some people, or you've seen no doubt on Facebook and such, says somebody might say, if you're a praying person, would you pray for? I had a guy sent me a personal message that said, you know me and my background. In fact, he had made some disparaging comments about me on some Christian posts that I had made on Facebook, and he made some disparaging comments about those and kind of heckling or ridiculing about the faith until his dad got really sick. And his dad got really sick in the hospital, and he says, I know you're a praying person and you know I'm not, but if you wouldn't mind, I'd appreciate your prayers. I thought that, you know, the flesh side of me was like, why? You know, why do you think it's going to do any good? You know, this kind of thing. But the fact of the matter is, Melanie and I were reading something, or actually she was sharing with me one of the things she had been reading, talking about eternity. The fact is, God has set, Ecclesiastes tells us this, God has set eternity in man's heart. It's an undeniable thing. We can't shake it. God made us for himself and for eternity. And so there's that sense. And so some people, just in desperation, they cry out. But in all of these things, look, I hear irreligious people. Now, they might call themselves religious, but certainly not Christian, right? As I've had opportunity to try to share the gospel with somebody, and I would ask them about their relationship with Christ, very often their first response is, oh, I pray to God every day, right? And so that's the sense of it, is I just, you know, I pray to God. There's not a sense necessarily of relationship, certainly not understanding of sin, repentance, or even Jesus. I just make it a habit. I, you know, voice a prayer upward, you know, kind of a deal. So everybody, almost everybody at least, prays at one time or another, faith or no faith. And the fact is there are both, as it goes then, there are both positive examples and negative examples that can influence us in our praying. In this case, what we're going to see, Jesus is using negative examples to help prepare and warn his disciples about what prayer shouldn't be, right? He's going to say, look, prayer is going to look like this in some contexts and from some people, and I'm warning you, that's not what real prayer is, so avoid these. But I just thought real quickly, I just thought this might be a neat thing. There could also be really positive examples of praying too, right? Now, obviously in the disciples' life, Jesus was that. They observed that in him, and it was that thing that prompted them to say, Lord, teach us to pray. But I'm just guessing in a room this size with this many people, some of you would have somebody that you would say, for me, this person is a tremendously positive example of a prayer and of how I believe we ought to pray, you know, to God. Anybody have one of those? Charles? I knew you were going to say that. I would agree with you. Yeah. Somebody else? Right. Who was it for you, Skip?
Dr. George Kirkendall out at Leavenworth.
Mm-hmm. Who else? Who's got somebody? Wow. Wow. I just heard a voice from on high. Yeah. That's a good one. She said Sharon. Yeah, I know. Somebody else was going to say something. Who else? I thought about two. One is Miss Betty Averett in a senior adult Sunday school class at Wake Crossroads. I remember they would call on her every week to pray. It made me wonder if anybody else in that class knew how to pray besides her. But I understood why they did. The comment that I made after hearing her pray a couple of times was, you know, Miss Betty, whenever I hear her pray, she prays like she knows who she's talking to. The other person, and he's actually preached here, I guess back in April, is Michael Clower. He was the pastor at Inglewood Baptist in Rocky Mount. He's been a real friend and mentor to me, and multiple times I've called him for counsel, encouragement, advice, whatever it was. And we would be talking, and I'd be sharing with him about what was going on, and he would respond sometimes, mostly listen, you know, and that sort of a thing. And I would finish a sentence, just whatever my thought was about what he had said or what we were talking about. And all of a sudden, without missing a beat, without saying anything, he would just say, "Father, right now, I just lift up my brother." And he would just go right on praying precisely for whatever it was. It was as natural as him breathing when we were in conversation with one another. And so you know, I say that to say, be aware, watch, listen. One, we can learn, right? We can learn from the people around us. Jesus is going to warn us, pay attention who you choose as a model, right? But at the same time, let God bless you, teach. This is what the body of Christ is about. Let God bless you, encourage you, grow you, teach you by watching and listening to people as they talk to God. Because God can grow you that way if you'll let him. But Jesus uses two examples to avoid, and I'm wrong in my notes. Last week had 3 points, tonight has two, but it still says three nevertheless. So if you want to just mark that out and put two pitfalls to avoid, you can do that if you want to in your notes. The first one, and this really relates to Matthew 6, verses 5 and 6, avoid praying in a way that sees God as useful rather than beautiful. Avoid praying in a way that sees God as useful rather than beautiful. Listen to these two verses again here in Matthew 6, verses 5 and 6. "And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward." That's really the warning, right? So what do you see in that verse in Matthew 6, 5? What do you see in terms of the warning that gives indication that these, that Jesus is warning about, they see prayer and their interaction with God as more useful than seeing God as beautiful? What do you see? What do you notice? Yeah, that's right. So she said they're using their in the moment, so-called, I would even say, and I'll explain this more in a minute, they're using their so-called interaction with God in the moment as a vehicle by which to draw attention to themselves. Number one, what does it show as the posture when they're in the synagogue? What does it say? What are they doing? They're standing, right? Now, it's not that it's wrong to pray standing, but the point is Jesus is making a note here of what they're doing. They're standing, and likely in a way, maybe even arms raised and this kind of a thing, but their posture is such that they're drawing attention to themselves. But not only is it their posture, it's their position, because not only do we see them praying in the synagogue this way, where else does it say they pray? The street what? The street corner. Now, what's the deal about a street corner? Yeah, that means there's at least two roads passing, right? If you're on a street corner, there's not a corner on a single road, right? There's got to be crossroads for there to be a street corner. And if there's a crossroads and there's a corner, it means there's a crowd in that day when everybody's traveling by foot. So when they're in the synagogue, they're standing, letting their posture draw attention. When they're outside, they're standing at the street corner, letting their position draw attention. But Jesus doesn't hesitate to reveal the deal of their heart, because he says right here very clearly what their intent is. They're doing these things. Look at the towards the end of verse 5. That they may be seen by others. In fact, some would even argue that while they would call it prayer, the fact is they're not talking to God at all. It's more like they're talking to the people in front of them about God, right? For the sake of their own benefit. For the sake of, like, just like Patty said, you know, things like spiritual power or prestige, recognition, position. The fact is, it has to do with self-righteousness, really, because proximity to God is what people looked at for sort of stature, especially in the Jewish community. So the deal is, hey, look at me. I'm close to God, therefore I'm something. I'm holier. Right? This kind of a thing. And so, but all of that activity, all of that action, you know, says, look at me, look where I am. And the fact of the matter is, they really weren't talking to God. Look at this next quote here. The religious person prays to get something from God, but the gospel person prays to get more of God. The word that I wrote down there is moocher. Right, the sense of it is I'm staying close to God so that I can mooch from him. I can get off of him what I want for myself. And my reason for staying close in proximity is not following, it's not submission, it's not worship, it's what I want. And that's the sense of it, even as Jesus exposes their heart. Their so-called closeness or proximity to God is more for what they think they can get from him. And what does Jesus say at the end of verse 5? What does he say about what they're actually going to get? Yeah. Yeah, that's right. So he says what they've got is all they're going to get. Now, here's the deal. What were they trying to get? Recognition from whom? Yeah. Right? That's it. That's the deal. The point is all they're going to get is what doesn't matter. The opinion of those around them who see and hear. What they're going to miss is what they really need, and that's God's approval, who not sees just our posture or our position, but he sees our heart, right? Just like he said to Samuel when he's setting aside David as king. Man looks on the outward appearance, but God looks on the heart. We see this picture in the other story Jesus tells about the Pharisee and the publican, right? The tax collector praying in the temple. It says one stands right there, you know, near the window where everybody can see, oh God, I thank you that you hear me when I call to you, and I thank you that I'm not like that wicked dude over there in the corner. Right? And that's basically what he says. When the reality is, it's the guy in the corner calling out, laying on the ground almost. But just pretty much all he can do with his posture to hide the fact that he's even there beating on his chest, calling out, God, be merciful to me, the sinner. Right? God will hear one of those prayers. He'll ignore the other. One is bent towards man's perspective, and one is actually calling out to him. But so, again, the religious person prays to get something from God. The gospel person prays to get more of God. The gospel person realizes that the great prize of salvation is God. Don't miss that. Because even in church, a lot of times we hear talk about, you know, we really hear talk about the benefits of salvation, you know, eternal life, heaven, you know, all these kinds of things. But the deal is that the greatest gift of salvation is God. He is the prize. Now, when we are in him, when we have a relationship with him, we have forgiveness, we have life, we will live forever in his presence in heaven, and those things are great and wonderful. But the great prize really is God himself. He's the one that we should long for, which it goes to the next thing. If God is beautiful,
to you, then you'll love to pray. If God is beautiful to you, then you'll love to pray. What that means is that when I see the value of my relationship with God, I want to be with him. I aggravate Melanie all the time about our times early in the morning. She gets up way before I do, sometimes on purpose, sometimes not. But anyway, you know, at least usually by 5 or 5:15, I'm doing good to drag out by 6 or 6:15. But anyway, by the time I get to the sunroom for us to sit and read together, she's already at least one cup of coffee in, and she is wound up. And she's talking. And I'm still trying to get started on my first cup of coffee, right? And so I aggravate her about sitting there, me listening and her talking and all that kind of thing. But you know, one of the things, I wouldn't trade that time for us together, in part simply because it's that time for us to be together, right? Because of our relationship with one another. Because of our opportunity to pray together or read the devotional book that we use together and that kind of thing too. But just that time together, even though I sit there and I aggravate or tell her sometimes my ears are tired, you know, or something that early in the morning. The deal is it's the nature of that relationship and that desire to spend the time together. That's what JD's getting at here when he says, if God is beautiful to you, then you'll love to pray. You know, we'll want to be with him. That's the deal. Not just to run up to make our appeals or to ask for our things, but just to be with him, right? To do that kind of a Psalm 46:10, be still and know that he is God. You know, just sitting with him, communing with him. That's really the picture we see in Jesus' life, is that kind of intimacy with the Father. He longs to be with his Father. And the disciples saw that and they knew that. Next, it says we become hypocrites when we are more interested in what we can get from God than we are in God himself. We become hypocrites when we are more interested in what we can get from God than what we are in God himself. The word hypocrite means mask wearer. It actually was a theater term used for one who would put a mask on to portray something other than what they really were. They would put a mask on and say, I'm acting like this person, but in reality, if I take my mask off, I'm actually this thing. And Jesus says the fact is that those who use God because they find him useful as opposed to praying to him out of relationship with him, they're like mask wearers, because what they would claim on the outside with their mask on is I love and long for and desire this relationship with God, when behind the mask it's really about what do I want from him, you see. And so Jesus said, that's a hypocrite. That's an actor. That's a pretender that gives an appearance of a love for God, but really has a love for self. He gives us a measuring stick. This last line here at the bottom. A good measure of my praying is, how do I pray when I'm in secret? Now you might just write out there beside that, do I pray in secret? Do I pray, right? So because that's part of it, right? If I'm not spending that intentional time in what I would call relational prayer, fellowshipping prayer, as opposed to simply petitional prayer, then I need to ask, okay, what's driving my praying in the first place? Is it relationship with God, where I long to be with him, to acknowledge who he is and give thanks to him for who he is, and to love him, the one that has reconciled me to himself? God, I just thank you today that I'm your child. And God, during the day, sometimes today, I'm gonna forget that. In fact, the enemy's gonna try to convince me of something else, that I'm no good, that I don't have any value, that, you know, that I can't do anything right or whatever. And so God, right now, I just thank you for the truth that I know that I'm your child. And I just want to thank you that you have saved me and you've made me yours, and that I can call you Father.
You know, that's it. That it really is just as simple as relational praying to him, focused on that relationship without any, ask some of you grandparents, what if every time your grandchild was ever around you, the only thing they did, the only thing, is run up to you and say, can I have this? Can I have that? Some of you saying, that's what they do. But you know, I remember sometimes sitting on that 5-gallon bucket on the creek bank with Pawpaw. And we were crappie fishing. We called it crappie fishing in Alabama, but I'm bilingual, I can speak North Carolina. So we were crappie fishing, sitting on that 5-gallon bucket, and he was sitting next to me. And the fact of the matter is, I didn't care if we were catching any fish or not, because I was with him. I enjoyed the time together. Now, would I ask him, hey, let's go fishing, or can we go down to the store and go buy some gum, or can we, yeah, sure. You know, if we recognize the relational burden of that, if we feel that, right, that sense of burden of, man, it'd sure be nice sometimes just to get a hug just because it's a hug, not because I want the next thing. Man, let that shape your heart toward how you respond to God, who is our Father. That you intentionally go to him and say, God, I'm not coming to ask you for anything. I have needs. You know them better than I can ask you for them. But right now I'm not coming really to ask you for anything other than just to say, I love you and thank you for making me your child. Man, that'll change us, right? That'll change us. It'll change our heart. It'll change our mind. It'll change our perspective. If we sometimes just sit with him. I remember when my kids were little, the joy of them just coming and climbing up in my lap. They didn't want anything. They just wanted to sit in Dad's lap. That's the sense that I get when the psalmist says, when God says through the psalmist, be still and know that I am God. That I'm just content to crawl up and sit in his lap and lay my head against him, and if nothing else, just listen to his heartbeat. Not say anything. You know, what is my practice of prayer, even in silence, in secret, say about whether I view God more as useful or as beautiful? Now, I was thinking about this as I worked through this chapter, and I want to be really careful with a warning here. I think Jesus' admonition, obviously, he's doing this very intentionally as a contrast for how these religious hypocrites were acting. And he's trying to show them, look, praying is not for show, it's for relationship. You're not praying so that other people can hear you. You're praying because you know who you're talking to, right? Like I said, Miss Betty. What I want to be careful of, and particularly in a gathering like this where we sometimes do pray together and pray aloud, the warning here is not don't ever pray out loud because all of us really at our hearts are hypocrites, right? We should, in fact, the scripture is replete with guidance and opportunities and demonstrations of public praying. We see that. We see the church coming together to pray. So don't let Jesus' admonition here, or even don't let the pattern or the intimidation, maybe even it would be a way to say it, of Miss Betty's or of Michael's praying, cause you to say, man, I can never pray like Miss Betty, or I could never pray like Michael, so therefore I'm not ever going to pray out loud where others could hear. Don't let that hinder you, because the fact of the matter is, in our praying, what we're doing is talking to our Father, right? All of your kids don't talk to the Father in the same way, do they? Right? If you've got a 2-year-old and a 12-year-old and a 22-year-old, now God bless you if you do, if they're that wide apart. Hopefully one got adopted somewhere in that kind of a stretch. But nevertheless, if you've got kids that are that far apart, wouldn't you expect that they're going to talk to Dad different? And even with our difference in chronological age doesn't always guarantee spiritual maturity, does it? People are at different places in our spiritual walk. We just are. So don't let the way those around you pray hinder you from just expressing your heart to our Father, even out loud, even in front of other people. I just wanted to remind us of that, because I think sometimes we might wrongly draw the conclusion, well, Jesus is saying we shouldn't pray in public. That's not what he's saying. He's drawing a contrast here with those who were doing it for show. The second thing is avoid praying in an attempt to impress God. Avoid praying in an attempt to impress God.
Look at these latter two verses that we read a moment ago, verses 7 and 8. Jesus says, and when you pray, don't heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them. For your Father knows what you need before you ask Him. Avoid praying in an attempt to impress God. Listen, you can go ahead and fill these next blanks and then we'll talk about it. We don't need to earn God's favor for Him to hear and respond to us. You know, what Jesus is saying here is that He's talking about the Gentiles, and they were famous for their orations and rhetorical skill and this kind of a thing. You know, you think about the philosophers at Mars Hill in Acts 17 and this kind of thing, these great orators and speakers. Some of them made fun of Paul. This guy can't speak, you know, this kind of a deal. And so in the Gentile culture, there was a lot of effort put on this idea of rhetoric and eloquence and these kinds of things. You know, somebody was much smarter and this sort of deal. And so the sense of it was there are those that have that capacity, and what they're doing is using these big and long and eloquent words and phrases and sentences, and sometimes they would say them over and over again. And the sense of it is the more words I use, the more likely it is that God's going to respond. In other words, I've got to convince God. I need to show that I'm worth Him responding to. So I need to string together the longest and the loftiest and the whatever kind of a thing that I can put together with the hopes that He will hear and respond. That's the sense of it. It's I've got to buy God's attention and His willingness to respond. The sense of it would be, God is bent against me, and I need to perform in a way that I can get His attention and make Him willing to respond to me. That's the sense of what's going on here. Again, they thought more words, more chance. I thought about, in terms of a biblical example, 1 Kings 18, where Elijah's on Mount Carmel and the prophets of Baal are calling out and he's not answering. And we know there's a reason he wasn't answering, because he's not real. But what did they do? They start shouting. They start dancing. They start shouting louder. They start cutting themselves, right? They're doing everything they can. I need to get God's attention to hope that He'll answer me. And He says, here what you see the Gentiles doing is they're piling up words. He calls them, you see them here, He calls them, they're heaping up empty phrases. Why? Because, the end of verse 7, because they think that they will be heard for their many words. You know what Jesus says? To borrow the title of the book, just ask. See, you know, you can't inform God about your situation in a way that He doesn't already know. He said, you don't need strings and strings of words. You don't need lofty ideas. You don't need a ton of repetition. You don't need to go on and on and on to try to earn your place. He said, here's the deal. You're talking to your Father. He knows what you need already. Just ask. Don't avoid praying in an attempt to impress God. I like this this quote that I put, it was here at the end of this section. I thought it was really good in tying all this together. What Jesus wants us to see is that there is a specifically, oh, wait a minute, I didn't give you the last blank. If I was you, I'd be nervous, because you need it filled in. We have to recognize that our Father invites us to fellowship with Him in prayer. All right, back to the quote that you see there. What Jesus wants us to see is that there is a specifically Christian way to pray. Christians pray with the awareness of God as their Father, who already knows them, loves them, and is aware of what they need. Their main driver in prayer is not to inform God about the needs in their lives that He's forgotten, or to curry favor with Him, but to spend time with Him. I mentioned that a moment ago. The note that I just wrote down here in my notes is just, a child who just loves dad.
You know, that's the nature of praying that that God desires for us to have. Now there are a few other what he called prayer don'ts, and frankly, I didn't include all of them. For those of you who have the book, you'll realize I left some out. Some of them I thought he just went a little overboard on. Some of them I thought, frankly, were just kind of his pet peeves, but I wouldn't really critique if somebody were doing that. And so if you've got the book, you're free to read them and decide if you want to employ them or not. But I did think, in particular, I thought three of them were worth noting. In some ways, some of these may sound nitpicky, so I want to be careful and make it clear that that's not what we're saying here. But it does matter how we approach some of these things, especially not only in our own lives, but because our desire is to communicate the truth of the gospel to others, and others are watching us, others are listening to us. And so these things do matter. And so I thought it would be helpful to mention a few of them. One is, don't ask God to do things he has already promised. Right? It's almost as if, you know, well, I'm not sure. You know, God, I want you to do this. God, I just pray that you'll, here would be an example. God, I just pray that you'll never leave me or you'll never forsake me. Well, hadn't he already promised that? What would be an alternative in light of God's promise that we might pray rather than, God, I pray that you will never leave me nor forsake me? How might we pray otherwise? Yeah. That's exactly right. That's the key. What we're not saying is God's promises are unimportant or we shouldn't address them, talk about them, think about them. No, that's not what we're saying. What we're saying is claim them, but don't ask him for them. He's already promised to do that. So instead of asking him to do what he's already promised to do, instead, thank him that he's promised to do it and walk in light of what he's promised to do. So I'm in the midst of a situation that's just incredibly burdensome and scary. Father, you know. Go ahead.
Yeah, but sometimes you can't say that. Father, I know you promised, but I don't feel.
Yeah.
Help me to rest in.
Yes. Yeah. That's a great point. A great way to say that. I don't, in case you didn't hear her in the back, this is a great point. Not in a doubting of God's promise way, but I don't know about you, but I've been in the situation she's talking about. I know God has promised. He will never leave me nor forsake me, right? I know that. But sometimes I might, in my emotions and in my response to my circumstance, I might feel pretty alone. Anybody ever been there? Yeah. So, what do? We talk to our dad who knows his kids and loves his kids. We're honest with him about what our experience is. Again, not because he doesn't know, but because we need him. And so she said one way that you might voice that would be, Father, I know you've promised you'll never leave me nor forsake me, but right now I feel really alone. So God, help me to rest in knowing that you are with me. You see? So again, we're acknowledging the promises God has made. I think a lot of times people feel like in our Christian lives that the only way to live a really mature Christian life is to act like nothing ever gets sideways. Man, read the Bible. Right? Look throughout all of the New Testament and faithful people of God that are facing just horrible circumstances. Paul says, look, I've cried out to God three different times. Take this thing away. And he prayed it until God said, stop it. Stop asking me for that because I'm just telling you I'm not taking the thing away. And the reason I'm not, it's for your good and my glory, because if I took it away, you'd be proud and you'd exalt yourself. I'm leaving it so that you'll remain humble and I can use you. And all of a sudden, Paul says, okay, God, I get it. I rejoice in my infirmities so that the power of Christ might rest upon me. Read the Psalms, for goodness sake. You talk about crying out after crying out after crying out. You know, I love it. Crying out the reality of the pain of the experience and then resting in the promise that God has made. You know, Psalm 73 is an example of that. David's crying out, God, I look around me and it looks like the whole world is against me. People are ridiculing me for my belief in you, and it looks like those who hate you have got the world by the tail. All of this is so overwhelming to me, I just want to give up. I just feel like I'm at the end. And yet he says, and then I went into the tabernacle of the Lord. And there I understood therein. What did he do? He said, I looked around and I was overwhelmed like crazy. And then I decided, God, I'm not in the midst of this. I need to worship. I put my eyes on you, and all of a sudden I realize what's going on. They think that they've got the world by the tail, and they think that the people of God are the ones who are suffering. But God, here's the reality. You have set their feet in slippery places, and surely their destruction will come quickly. You see? So the deal is he acknowledged the pain, the difficulty, he was almost to the point of despair. And yet God calls him to worship, and he rests in the promise of God. He says, I get it, God, that you are who you say you are. So it's a great opportunity for us as God's children. We don't have to be dishonest with God. Frankly, we don't have to be dishonest. We should not be dishonest with one another. If we're struggling, we ought to say we're struggling. That's why the body of Christ is important. Because today it may be that you're struggling and I can encourage you, but tomorrow it may be that you're struggling or I'm struggling, you need to encourage me. But that's why we need one another, to just be honest about where we are and say, hey, you know what? I get it. But I also know that God's faithful. Here's what he said. And so we can help one another walk like that. Yeah, all the time, isn't he? That's right. So don't ask God to do things he's already promised. Instead, rest in those. Rest in those promises and thank him for them. Second, don't use prayers to lecture people, aka preach praying. I would say be careful. Don't do this against your kids or family members, right? It's not the best way to teach your kids spiritual truth. God, I just pray, you know what Josh has done. God, you know it's wrong. God, you know he shouldn't have done it. God, he knows he shouldn't have done it. God, I pray you just bring great conviction on him. You see what I'm saying? It's almost like I'm not even really talking to God. I'm talking to Josh, and I'm pretending like I'm talking to God because I'm trying to teach him through what I'm praying, supposedly to God. But really, my attention's on, I'm trying to fix him, right? Sorry, Josh, if you're watching. It was just an example. but you see what I'm saying? The deal is not, I'm really not praying to God, asking him really for something in particular. I'm trying to make a point to those listening. Listen, I've probably done that here sometime. I don't know. If I have, don't come and tell me. The particular example, number one, I don't want to know. Number two, I'm me feeling really bad that you thought about it enough to remember it and come tell me. But pastors can do that, right? I mean, pray against the people in a way that they're calling it praying to God, but it's almost like throwing darts. Don't do that. Those almost certainly would be those cries out to God in the secret place, right? I'm not saying don't pray for those that you love, obviously. What I'm saying is don't use prayer as a weapon against them. In a way that, now look, it's fine for you to pray against the people that you love if they're not walking with God. In fact, some of you have heard me praying for your family members, praying that God, would you be as if it were the hound of heaven pursuing them, that they would sense you in pursuit of them, calling them to stop in their tracks and to turn their life to you. God, I pray that as the hound of heaven, you would pursue them and they would know it and they would stop and they would surrender. I'm not saying, by all means, pray those prayers for them. I'm saying don't pray those kinds of things at them as if you're using prayer as a weapon in your praying. Then finally, think about the prayer requests that you share with others. Think about the prayer requests that you share with others. One would just be, you know, ask yourself, when even in the things that you're praying and that you would ask others to pray, am I really praying in a way that I can be confident I'm praying in God's will towards God's plan? Or am I just really praying for what I want? In some cases, maybe I might even know,
God doesn't want this. He said in his, be careful about what you're asking for. Are you praying in line with God's will and God's plan? What he said in his word, right? Are you praying in a way, we talked about this, this was kind of a humorous example. Are you asking God to break the rules? Right? I mean, for your kid who hadn't studied for the test. Man, pray that, that Josh will pass the test. I'm just picking on Josh tonight. Would you just pray that Josh will pass this test? He really needs this grade. He hasn't studied one lick. But just pray that he'll remember what he needs to for the test. You know, praying that God would break the rules. God's plan is you be diligent, you be responsible, you study, you use the capacities he's given you. You remember those things, right? So we're not asking him to break the rules in that. The other one, and this is, man, this is so, it's sad to need to say this, but I'm going to say it. Are my prayer requests just an opportunity to gossip, right? Now look, I'm not trying to talk about anybody, but you just really need to pray for Charles. I mean, did you hear what was going on with him? I mean, we need to pray for him. And then I go on to tell something on Charles that I've got no business saying, and maybe I don't even know if it's even true or not. But I heard it, and I'm telling it. And what's the saddest part of all is I'm using prayer as a vehicle, as a supposed vehicle, a prayer request as a vehicle for gossip. Don't do that. If you have any question or concern about whether or not you ought to be saying something, don't. Just tell God. Just talk to him about it. That's always okay, right? But don't use prayer requests as an opportunity to gossip towards others, about others. That never honors the Lord. Well, we've got 8 minutes left. That's a miracle. This is the first week in 4 that we have. So here's what I want us to do. Want to guess? Pray. That's right. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to ask Mel if you will sign off the live stream for us.